We'll start now. Okay.
Please go
Hi,
ahead.
everybody. Good evening and welcome to this big Butterfly Month talk. Today's talk is basically the effect of climate change on monarch overwintering sites. It will be presented by Narayani Barve, ma'am. She's an assistant scientist in the Florida Museum of Natural History. And in this talk, the audience will be introduced to correlative modeling methods that can be used to predict the potential shift in species distributions for butterflies mostly. And the case study that will be presented would be on monarchs overwintering sites in Mexico and how that is reacting or responding to the climate changes there. So without further ado, over to Narayani, ma'am.
Thank you, Shantanu, for the nice introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. And today I'm going to talk on what is the effect of climate change on monarch butterflies overwintering sites. Before that, I'm going to talk about the concepts and definitions of correlative niche models. So the outline of my talk, first I'm going to talk about the species distribution models. Why do we need to use them? What are the concepts of niches and the definition of it? And then I will talk about the important areas like the conceptual framework of the areas of distribution, where I will touch upon a BAM framework and then introduce you to the geographical space and environmental space. Then I'll touch upon the occurrence data because that is the most important part. And I think as part of this, Big Butterfly Month and the other efforts to collect occurrence data, we should be very clear how the occurrence data is generated. And then I'm going to talk about the monarch overwintering sites. So that's going to be the outline of my talk. So let's dive in. Why do we care about species distributions? Basically, this is a question which is being asked from ages. And people are really investing time and effort in understanding the species distribution. Why do we need it? Because if you really want to see what is the habitat loss, and because of habitat loss, if we are losing any species, we need to know where the species exist. So for, you can say, for habitat loss and degradation, you need species distributions. Then there could be another area where you need to know species distribution is niche conservatism. So what is niche conservatism? Is like the niches are being conserved over time. So from millions of years, the species will respond to certain climatic factors similarly. So if the niches are conserved, or after a few years, the niches are going to be changed. And because of that, if the species are going to be splitted. So you need to know what is the conservatism in niches. So for that, you need to know the distributions. Then most important thing which the current world is facing is invasive species spread. You can see that in many parts of the world, there are species coming from the native range, and then it invades the newly available geographical areas. We have a lot of examples in India where you can see the species are actually spreading so fast that we cannot control them. So to understand how the species is going to spread in a novel areas, you need to know where is the native species distribution and how it is going to respond to novel areas. So that is one important part for understanding species distributions. And not only that, I touched upon this on the niche conservatism and also on the speciation processes. We need to know that how the species speciate, you know, because after a certain time, there are sister species, they are very closely related in their ecological niche, but there are certain speciation processes, because of that, they are separated. So to understand that, you need to know the species distributions. Well, fine and good. This is what we need to know for species distribution. What are the ideas of getting those species distributions? There are various ways. Many times the experts go to the field, collect the data, draw the ranges. Okay, I can see this species, so I draw this range. This is the distribution of the species. But you all know that one cannot really go and check for all the geographical areas. So the knowledge with the experts is going to be sometimes limited. Not always, but sometimes, because if the efforts are not put more, then it's going to be the limited knowledge. So there are methods like species distribution models, where you can use the occurrences and the data, the background environmental data, correlate those two things statistically, and then derive the response of the occurrences with the climate, and then take that response and project it on the geography. So that is the core concept of species distribution models. So Gissan and Zimmerman actually defined that concept very succinctly in this definition. They said that it is an empirical model relating to field observations and background environmental predictor variables, and then based on statistically and theoretically derived response surfaces. So I'm going to talk about it more, but there are two major things here. One is field observation and environmental predictors. So if you don't have proper field observations and if you don't have proper environmental predictor variables, your correlations are going to be affected, right? So those two important things keep in mind. I'm going to touch upon it in my talk later. So let's go ahead. There are many in the field, actually, the species distribution model, you will see there are multiple names given to it. Sometimes it is also called as habitat suitability index. Sometimes it is called gap models. Sometimes it is called climate envelope models, occupancy models, and whatnot. But there are certain differences between each models. There are very slight differences, and there are some caveats when we talk one model with versus another. But here in this particular talk, I am going to consider only the ecological niche models. So let's see why do you use this model. So let us see some examples where people used these species distribution models and generated very interesting results. So the first example, there are ample examples on the species distribution model uses, and the field is growing so fast that it is really difficult to catch up with all the literature. So I'm going to give only few examples here. So in one of the example here, sorry, okay. So in this example, these people, Pottier et al., they actually try to find out how the plants are assembled based on the environmental gradients. So they took multiple plant occurrences, they did niche models, and then tried to see if the elevation is actually really changing the plant assemblages. And then they found very interesting results that at higher elevation, there are different assemblages, and at lower elevations, there are different assemblages. So another example could be, you can design a reserve or you can do conservation using species distribution models. So in this case, in Madagascar, they used high spatial resolution data, used various taxonomic data like plants, birds, insects, and all that. And then they developed this distribution model. So have multiple species distribution overlaid on top of another. And wherever they found the maximum species are found in one particular place, they proposed that this is the area which you can conserve, because in less time and money, you are going to save more species. So this is one more aspect of using species distribution models. Then, as I said earlier, you can see what is the species in invasion potential and how can it proliferate in the future. So this is one of the species which is invasive in Florida, but the native range is from India. So the species was introduced in Florida somehow, and then it just caught up with all the available niches available, and it started growing, and now it is invaded, and it's very difficult to remove this species from here. So the next example was, like, you can also use species distribution to see what is the impact of climate or what is the impact of land use change in the species distributions. So here they used multiple models at different spatial resolutions. for terrestrial vertebrates communities, and then they found that the distribution is going to change from different climatic scenarios from present to future. Another example, this is a very cool example. I really liked it, this paper. This is also from Madagascar. So what they did, they took the known occurrences from the available data and also field surveys. And then they did this correlative model. Then they projected the model on whole Madagascar. And then you can see that they found different areas where the suitable climate was available. So they went into those areas. And then they surveyed, and what they found 7 new different species. So you can use this species distribution modeling approach to find out new species also. Then other use could be to introduce, to find out the species, the area suitable for the species, and introduce those species there for restoration or rewilding. This is a little, I would say, ethically or morally debatable concept, but you can certainly use this approach. And then Peterson et al. In 1999, they tried to find out whether the species is speciating because of the barrier. So this is a barrier here. And then try to see the species because of the barrier here and here, if the niches are same. So you can use that approach in the terms of evolutionary context. The other use, what you can do is also to find out what happened in the past. I only talked about what is happening in the present scenario, what is going to happen in the future. But not only that, you can also see what had happened in the past. So we know that there is this last glacial maximum a few hundred years ago. And then what happened that time? Because that time everything was cold. So where all these species went? So we want to know some of the areas where species could change, like species could move and survived. And because of that, we are seeing those species now. So to know the refugees, you can use this distribution model. Then, not only that, in Great Basin in United States, there are certain populations. They are actually same species, but they are populated very distinctly. Like distance is but too far between those two populations. Then why that could have happened? So they tried to see if there was a connectivity between those populations in the past. So you can do connectivity analysis as well. Not only that, you can use if the sister species share the same climatic niches or not, that you can see using this phylogenetic niche occupancy methods. These all actually uses species distributions at the background. This is one of the paper I was involved in when I started working in Florida Museum. Here, what we did was we actually took all the plant species available. Not all, we had like 1/3 of the plant species available in Florida, generated species distributions for all those, and then tried to see where is the highest plant diversity, but not only in terms of the distribution, but we also tried to see if they are closely related species are assembled together or not. So phylogenetically, if they are closely related or they are not. So the thing is, if you have high phylogenetic diversity index, that means the far distant species are assembling at one point. So we wanted to test whether the richness and the phylogenetic diversity matches in Florida. So that is another use. This is also a very cool application, I would say, with niche models. I'm also one of the author in this paper. Here, what we did was we took multiple snake species distributions. We developed the distribution model in the present, and then we projected it in the future. These are all venomous snakes. And then we, with our data, we showed that the snakes are, and you are going to have more venomous snakes in the future in the northern areas in United States. So, okay, so that's great. We can do so many things with this. Okay, but how should I do it? What are the ways? What are the methods? So what I need to know before I use them? So first and foremost, as I said earlier, that this is nothing but a correlative approach. So you take your known occurrences, you take the background environmental data, correlate it statistically, project it on the geography. So there are two concepts here: occurrences, environmental data, and the geography you are projecting. And this geography could be your same area where you are training your model. It could be a different area where you want to project it. It could be a different time span, as we have seen in earlier examples. Now, let's go back to the words here, because there are a lot of confusion in the word niche in the literature. So I'm just going to touch upon a little bit on what this niche is defined by different people, and then what is the concept of niche we use in ecological niche models. Just to be clear that is not the definition, but this is the definition we use. So let's go back to the history a little bit. And then in 1917, Grinnell, he defined niche of a species as a habitat. But we all know that habitat is not necessarily geographical. Many times, most of the time, we consider habitat is geographical, but not necessarily it is geographical. So he defined niche as habitat. So niche could be, habitat could be interior of a stem or a rotten log, or it could be a clump of a mass. That is the habitat. But that is certainly not explicitly geographical. Then came Alton. He said, no, niche is nothing but the function of that species in the community. And then with that definition, it is assumed that the species exists without any trouble. So the existence is assumed. But these both the definitions are really little different. And then you cannot really use one over another. So then in 1957, Hutchinson came, and then he said, no, niche cannot be only a habitat. It cannot be only a function, but it has to be a combination of all these. So then he defined the niche as a n-dimensional hypervolume of environmental condition where species can exist indefinitely. So when he said that species can exist indefinitely, that means he is suggesting that the growth rate of the species, the population, is greater than one. So this is more clearer definition of the niche. And this is the definition we use in our ecological niche models. So to understand, niche is n-dimensional hypervolume. So there are multiple factors because of which the niche of the species can be defined. Then another thing, niche is also geographic in nature. So you have to have geography to survive for this, like the species has to survive somewhere. So the geography has to be there. So it is explicitly geographic. And also it is based on environmental spaces, which consist of synopoietic variables. Now, what is this synopoietic variables? I will talk about it. So the synopoietic variables, why do you really need it? Synopoietic variables are actually broad scale. You can also consider them as abiotic variables. Though they are at the broad scale, they are dynamically linked at local scale. So for example, light availability for plants, right? That is a local scale phenomena. If you go to the evergreen forest, there is a competition between plants to get the light. So though the sunshine or the cloud cover, you can say, is a broad scale variable, but locally it is a light availability for plants. And then at coarser resolution, huge data sets of these synopoietic variables are available, because there are these atmospheric scientists who keeps creating different models by giving different variables. So you have many such coarser resolution synopoietic variable data sets available. And then, so it is easier for anybody to use ecological niche model because the background environmental data is available. But then, how do you define the areas of distribution? There are those abiotic or synopoietic variables are available, which are the physiological requirements of the species. Then, the important factor which everyone is concerned about is the biofactor, which is the interaction of the species. A single species cannot exist because that particular organism has to have some sort of a food or resource available. So the biotic components come into picture. So where you have abiotic conditions available, the climate basically available, where you have the food or resource available, the combination of those two areas in the the intersection of those two areas is where the species is going to survive. But not only that, there is the third important factor, which was actually proposed by Jorge Soberón from University of Kansas. He said that, okay, those two conditions are available, biotic and abiotic, but what if my species cannot go and reach to that particular spot? Are you going to find that species over there? No. So the accessibility part is very important. So that is a third factor. And then they define this conceptual framework as BAM. So abiotic conditions, biotic conditions, and movement. These are the three factors by which you are going to see your species in certain area. So then they define that the area of these three factors together is where your occupied geographical distribution of your species. If by somehow you change the M factor and then your species can reach to this area where abiotic and biotic requirements are available, then your species is going to certainly survive in that region. So they call this region as invadable geographical area. And then there is this Altonian noise hypothesis in the literature. What it talks about, I just want to tell you this briefly, because when we talk about the interaction between species, one species is depending on another, that species is depending on another, that species is depending on another. So there is so much interaction. So if you keep on taking this interaction into consideration, you will not be able to do anything because it becomes very complicated. So this Altonian noise hypothesis, what does it say? It say that when you go on a broader scale, actually the biotic interactions does not matter that much. It only matters the climate. So abiotic conditions matter a lot and the accessibility matter a lot. So just keep in your mind that biotic conditions are important, but in ecological niche models, we assume that the biotic conditions are available to the species. So then, well, fine and good. All we understood abiotic, biotic, accessibility and all that. But how do you relate these areas and niches together? So it is very simple. You have the geographic area. You divide that geographic area into small grids. That grid size is known as spatial resolution of your data. And then that each grid has background environmental condition. For example, for India, we divide temperature and precipitation layers into, say, 1 kilometer grid. So every grid is going to have some temperature and some precipitation. So that is your background environmental condition. And then in certain grids only, you are going to see your species. So your species is going to be occupied only in certain grids. That is one important part. Though the species can actually survive if it reaches another grid, it can survive. But currently, because you have seen the species in one particular grid, it is only there in certain parts, right? So that is one important thing. Now, for example, there is always this dual interaction, which is, this is also a technical term, they call it as Hutchinson's duality, that if you change your grid size, you are going to see a different picture of this environmental space. So here what I have done is I have just plotted the annual temperature on the x-axis and annual precipitation on the y-axis. And this is one, I think it is 5 kilometer grid for India. And then for each grid, there is this value. And I just plotted a 2D graph on the left side, which is an environmental space. So suppose if I'm interested in hot and wet area and I select this species, I select these grids, then what I get? I get Western Ghats and Northeastern parts where there is hot and wet conditions available. But if I'm interested in the cold and dry conditions and I click here on the environmental space, then what is the geographical representation of that is in Jammu and Kashmir and northern part of India. So there is this always this duality happening between environmental space and geographical space. And as I told you earlier in the definition that the model training happens in environmental space, and then you project it on the geographical space. But your occurrence data comes from the geographical space. So there is this interplay happening between these two spaces, and the grid size actually has an important role to play. If you have a very broad scale grid size, say like 20 kilometers, then the climate is going to be, or the background environmental data is going to be the average of those 20 kilometer grid size. But if you go on a local, like a 1 kilometer or say 500 meters, it is going to be different. So you should be very clear that the spatial resolution at which you work, your results are going to vary. Okay, so let's see how this, just an example, we talked about this BRAM framework and then the native range of this Lantana camera. This is a very badly invasive species in India. So this is a native range. What happens if your aim increases? Because the conditions are suitable in Americas and the same conditions are available in eastern part of the world. What happens if your M increases? I just increased my M little bit. And then you can see that the Lantana camera actually is invading India pretty badly and also in Africa and some other parts. So this is a native and invaded range. So when you do, after all this talk of half an hour, what are the two important things what you should think about always when you develop your niche models? So the most important factor I would say is your definition of M, which is the accessible area. So when you define your accessible area, always consider the dispersal ability of your species you are modeling. Always consider if there is a biogeographic barrier by which the species is not moving in other places. Always consider if there is any certain vegetation types or bioclimatic types, which ecotones or something which where your species actually lives. Take those as your, consider that as your M. Don't use rectangles. Don't use political boundaries. Species don't understand political boundaries. Something which is found in India can also be found in Pakistan. So don't take only political boundaries as your training region. You should consider it the range, what is the range of the species. And sometimes you can take the range maps developed by the experts, but don't use range map just as it is. You do something about it, like do the buffer, because sometimes the range maps are not that good. We are seeing it all the time in the data that it is not good. So what is the effect of this M? If you don't define this accessible area properly, your model parameterization is going to be affected. Your model validation, because we are just developing the models, we really do not know if these models are true or not. So we need to evaluate those models. If your area is not correct, your model evaluation is not going to be correct. You are not going to get good results. And then if you are comparing model two different species between environmental similarities, of two different species, if your areas are not defined properly, those niche similarity indices are not going to be giving you good results. So accessible area is very important. I would highly recommend to read Barve et al. 2011 paper, where we talk about this in detail. We show the simulation of the virtual species and how that is affecting all these three different three different categories. So please go and check it out before you read, before you do any species distribution models, this paper. The next part is occurrence data. How do you get the occurrence data? This could be like you go to the field, you collect the occurrence, you say that this species I found it. So that is the occurrence data. So that particular occurrence data has a place name, has a lat long, and you have the date when that particular observation has been made, and you have the name of the taxa, what you saw. So like I saw Philanthus emilica, that is Amla, in Kothrud on 24th February 2019, and I took a photograph as the evidence. So that is your primary, that is your occurrence data. But always it is not possible that you go and collect data for all the species. So there are certain, so there are certain websites where you can download the data. I will talk about it, but let's go back to the occurrence again here. So your occurrence is going to be coming only from the geographically occupied regions. And then the next graph, how are you going to say that it is a presence or absence? This is a little complicated picture. Don't worry about it. Just I'm going to show you this this path. So the region is accessible to the species. It is abiotically suitable. Yes, it is biotically suitable. Yes. That particular species is visited by the observer. So he said, okay, I have seen the species. So he says that I saw this Philanthus emilica so-and-so, time, date, whatever. And then the observation is correctly performed. Yes, it is correctly performed. So it is true presence. But what happens if the observer goes to the place and he does a wrong observation, then it is a false absence. Actually, it is present, but the observer is saying it is not there. So there are, similarly, you can have these multiple paths and see what is the true absence, what is the false absence, what is the real absence, and all that. So basically, absence is not really a true absence because it depends on multiple factors. Absence happens because it is non-accessible. It is because it is not suitable. That particular area is not suitable. You did not sample it, or you did mistake in reporting. So the absence is really a not true absence. That is very difficult to get true absence. So when you do these niche models, and if people are using presence absence method and then trying to project it on the past or future, then you should be really careful because you really do not know the absences was there in the past or absences are going to be there in the future. But you really know what is going to be in the presences. So give more weightage on the presence only model. There are different models, presences are presences, but there is another problem in that. It could be biased because sometimes people just go to the forest, but only go to the roads. They don't go interior. So they just collect the data. So they just go to the forest and only collect data close to the roads. So your data is biased. Sometimes data can come from the higher or lower spatial resolution data. And when you are combining those, you need to be careful. So there are some caveats only using only presence data as well. You should be careful about what you are doing. And then there are various websites they are aggregators. So many different data providers give data to these aggregators, and then you can download the data from those portals. There are like GBIF, which is the Global Biodiversity Information Facility. It houses billions of records for multiple species. Then IDIC Bio is one initiative from University of Florida. They also have a lot of data. India Biodiversity Portal, they also have data from India specifically. Species Link is one such website which houses data from Brazil. So there are multiple websites. Actually, I have not listed all this, but these are the ones which you can say that are more prominent. So you get your data, occurrence data from there. You have the background climatic variables. Now, what are the types of ecological niche models you have? There are multiple niche model methods, presence only, presence absence, or presence and pseudo absence method. So in presence absence, you have to give absence as a true absence. You assume that is a true absence, which in my mind is not always true. Sometimes it is not always true because there are a lot of biases attached to it. And then there is other method which is most popular in currently in the field in recent times is Maxent, which uses pseudo absences. So it takes your presence data. You have the background environmental data. So your M region, geographical region, it randomly places points and says that it is absence, but it correlates this presence absence together and then converts your your absence to sometimes presence. So that's why it is called as pseudo absence method. So let's go back. What I did using this, this concept of ecological niche models, what I did with Monarch. So as you know, there was a talk earlier by Toshita. She had explained a lot about monarchs. Monarch Danius plexippus, it has milkweed as a host plant and the life expectancy is from 2 weeks to 9 months. And the amazing phenomena for attached to this monarch is that they migrate from Canada to Mexico during winter. And the migration distance is about 3,000 miles, which is equal to 4,800 kilometers or around 5,000 kilometers. So this is a distribution of monarch. And the monarch which migrates are from Americas. So I'm going to focus, my talk is going to be only on talking about the overwintering sites here in Mexico. So what is the monarch migration? I'm just going to talk briefly about it. So this yellow arrow is nothing but the migration from, shows the migration from Canadian population to the Mexico, from Canada to Mexico. And the green arrow shows the migration of overwintering butterflies. When the winter is over, they go back, they lay eggs, then the next generation comes and the third or fourth generation actually reaches Canada. And then they lay eggs and they die. Then in Canada, the next generation starts and that generation actually comes back to this Mexico. This is in Mexico to overwinter. And Mexico, there is a large area for overwintering. In like few acres, and monarchs actually huddle up together on the pine or fir trees like this, and they are so closely together that sometimes you can see that the branches of the trees break because of the weight of these butterflies. And there are total 9 sites in Mexico. Among those 9 sites, Chincua and Al Rosario are the largest site. And in 1990, this large area was defined as Monarch Biodiversity Biosphere Reserve, which is like few acre area. And it is actually 10 years ago I did this work. So in 2004, Overhauser and Peterson, they found that there is a increase in frequency in lethal conditions for monarch. And because of these lethal conditions are frequent, more monarchs are dying. What are the lethal conditions? Basically, if there is cold and wet conditions at the night, especially if there is a wet condition before a cold night, that is very lethal. And monarch cannot tolerate that particular condition for more than few hours, so they die. So that was the premise, that the lethal conditions are increasing and maybe because of that monarchs are dying was the premise for the work which I did next. So what was the objective of my of this work? Are lethal events in monarch survival increasing? Because they talk about the events are increasing, but they only analyze data only for few years. So I am going to, this was actually a class project, and there are like 15 authors in this. And then we decided that, okay, let us see if the events are really increasing from like 25 years, what was like from 25 years, if the events are steadily increasing in the current present time period. And then that was one question. The next question was, okay, we have the occurrence data, we have the background environmental data. Are these overwintering sites going to respond differently in climate change? Are they going to survive if the climate change happens, and what's going to happen? So those are the two questions what we try to answer in this case study. So this Larson and Lee, they actually performed physiological experiments on monarchs, and then they found out that to read this graph, if you have precipitation, high precipitation, then monarchs die at about minus 4.2 degree Celsius. But if there is no precipitation, then monarch can survive at minus 7.7 degree Celsius. If the temperature goes below that, then the monarchs die. And at 7.7 degree Celsius, it's high mortality, but at 4.2, they certainly die, but not all, like about 50% is the mortality for monarchs. So that was the study done previously. So we used that information in our methods. So what we did was we collected weather station data, which were close to these nine sites, overwintering sites, which were less than 25 kilometers in distance from these sites. And we accessed the nightly data from December to February, from 1980 to 2005. It was hourly temperature data. And then what we did, we tried to calculate the distance to lethal conditions for each day. And we counted how many lethal days in that period, that is December to February, where during that period when the monarch overwinter. So how many number of days are there in each season from 1980 to 2005, that is 25 years. And we wanted to see if the number of lethal days are increasing as the year increases. So that was our one premise. And also, we also wanted to see if the distance is to the lethal conditions are coming fast to the fast enough in the recent period. So that was another thing. So for to do this, we got this data. And then we thought, okay, let us see what happens on two different time periods for 25 years and then only for 10 years. We did the same methods for 25 years and 10 years. And to answer the second question, we used overwintering site locations, used seven bioclimatic layers, and we used GARP, which is a genetic algorithm. This is again developed by University of Kansas people. And then we used using that method, that is also a presence only method. And then we used the results of that and projected it on the future in two different scenarios, that is A2 and B2. A2 is more extreme scenario, that means climate is going to change extremely. And B2 is like the climate is not going to change. It is going to change, but it is not going to change extremely. And then we overlaid the result of this on the current forest cover of the on that area. So what did we found? We found that during the 1985 to 2005, there was no significant result. We did not see that the number of days are actually changing so much, because we used this linear regression models with the number of days and the year number of days as a response and year as a independent variable, and we found there was no significant result. But then when we tried to do it only for the recent 10-year period, we found that the lethal conditions are actually closer, the trend was closer to the lethal conditions. So in the recent period, that the observation of the people, those who really visit the overwintering sites, was actually true from the data. Then in the next question, this is a present day distribution. These are the overwintering sites here, and you can see the dark orange. It is not really clear. It should have been a zoomed image, but it is not. I've just taken the image from the paper. So here you can see that these are the suitable conditions available, but you don't see monarchs in all those suitable conditions. We projected these areas into the future in the A2 scenario 2015. And then what we found, that this is that MBBR, that is monarch biodiversity. That MBBR. So you can see that in the future, what's going to happen is the suitable conditions are going to be moving a little bit to the northward. And then the forest cover is also not matching there. And also but the other thing what you can see here is that the suitable conditions are going to be available, abiotically, are going to be available here in these sites, but we really do not know if the monarchs are really going to move in those regions. So in conclusion, our results were little mixed. We saw that few weather stations showed that there was some significant results in the lethal temperatures, but not all stations showed us that result. And then also we saw in the niche models that there is going to be decrease in the current suitable habitat, but the novel habitats are going to be available for the species. The question is, we do not know if the species will really track those novel habitats and go there. And also the other thing is, if because of the land use change, if the people are going to keep those pine and fir forests intact in the future, if that habitat, those trees are not there, monarchs are certainly not going to survive there. So that was the mixed results what we say we got from our study. And I would say that because we did this study in 2010 and now it is 2020, so we have 10 more years of data available. So I think it would be pretty interesting if we apply the same ideas to the larger data set and see if there is any change happening. So I think that's all what I wanted to talk about today, and I'm ready to take any questions if you have. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, madam, for the talk. Whatever we could understand was very, very interesting. But there have been just a couple of questions that have come in. So basically from Mr. Srinivas Anantan. So I will take these questions one after the other. And in the meanwhile, if Mr. Anantan has got any, other questions pertaining to that, we will take them up also. So the first question is, just a moment. Yeah, what are the main factors to be considered while selecting an appropriate niche model, keeping in mind the trade-offs like detection probability, accessibility, etc.?
Okay, so the most important thing is study your species well. Study the biology of your species well. That is the most important thing. Until and unless you know how the species behave, what is the response of your species to different environmental factors like temperature, precipitation, humidity, you will not be able to choose your background environmental variables. Understand the ecology of your species very well before using these models, because this is just the mathematics. It is whatever you are going to give, it's going to correlate and give you the output. Suppose if you give garbage, you are going to get garbage out. So you should know the biology of your species, ecology of your species very well, and then only use the niche models. But when you are using the niche model, always consider the factors like from where your occurrences are coming and what is the accessible area of your species, because that's where you are going to train your model.
Second question is, can beta and gamma diversity also be assessed?
You can assess that, but then you need to have a stacked species distribution model for your taxa, basically. And then there are, because these are just the probabilities, right? You get the data as the probability of presence. So then this is talking about only the probability. So you have to take it with little understanding that when you stack it, you are just saying that, okay, this is going to be there. So to get your beta and gamma diversity, but then you are really not sure until unless you go to the field and check whether you really find that species or not. So you can certainly use this, but you have to be very careful when you interpret your results.
Okay. What is the difference between home range and territory? Does the definition of habitat and home range overlap each other?
So I really do not know what that, I mean, I, in the sense, I can talk about what is the home range of the species, that your individual is actually moving around in one particular region and it can move only in that region. But territory, I really do not know how it is. Maybe it is same as the home range. I'm not really the person who can define these two terms, I would say. And what was the second question?
Does the definition of habitat and home range overlap each other?
Habitat, no. So it does in some part, but when you are talking about home range, you talk home range of only certain populations, but your habitat and the whole distribution is made up of multiple populations. And then multiple populations will have multiple different habitat types where those live. So habitat is more sort of a local scale, but when we are talking about distributions, it is multiple of populations together. So you cannot really say that habitat and the home range actually is perfectly matching, but it's a subset.
Okay. Srinivas would also like to know a little bit about niche exclusion model in brief if possible.
Which model?
Niche exclusion model.
Well, I'm hearing this term right now. I really don't know.
Mr. Srinivas, if you are there, if you can unmute and explain what you exactly want to know.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah, sure.
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah. Okay. Like, I just wanted to know that is there any difference between, because in the subsequent, one of my subsequent questions, I've asked about niche partitioning and niche exclusion. Niche exclusion, what I mean is like by way of a competitive exclusion, one species gets excluded from a particular area and moves to another area. So I just want to know a bit more on that, or like, yeah, that's what I mean.
Okay. Yeah. It's a good question. The thing is, when you are talking about niche exclusion or niche partitioning, you are actually considering more into the biotic interactions of the species. And then to understand those, you need to have a lot of data associated with the biotic interactions between those species. And you can certainly take interaction as one of the background environmental variable in your model, and then run the correlative approach, and then see how the niche, how the two species are going to be distributed or excluded because of the competition between those two species. So you need to have the biotic component associated with those species in your models. Most of the times people use this ecological niche models or species distribution models, assuming that not taking into consideration the biotic interactions as such, but only the environmental or the climatic factors. But you can certainly do it if you have those data and information available.
The next question is, Can an untrained model be used while georeferencing and mapping?
What is untrained model here?
Again, Srinivas, could you unmute yourself?
Yeah, like I'm actually not very good in like mapping, but I just wanted to have this clarity about trained and untrained models. Actually, I too have a vague idea about this when it comes to georeferencing while mapping a species distribution range. So like I was just trying to find out like if untrained models can be used. Trained models is something you make the subject get used to, and then you know, you start actually mapping. Because I'm really new to this, I just heard in bits and pieces, so I just wanted to have some clarity on that.
Okay, so georeferencing is a different concept altogether. So basically, if you have the maps of some area and you want to georeference those maps or the occurrences of those species, I don't know what exactly you mean by georeferencing in this case. But georeferencing is you have certain map and you are trying to fit that map into the current, giving basically you are trying to give the geolocations, latlongs to that particular different map or the occurrence data. If that is what you want to do, there is no question of trained model and untrained model in this case. If you are trying to get the georeference for the species on the occurrences, like you know that in the literature, if you are reading that one particular species is found like 50 kilometers away from, say, Lasalgaon in northwest direction. And then you are trying to give the geolocation to that particular place. So you can actually go to Google Earth, try to find the town which is described in that particular place, find out the location, what it could be, and then maybe give uncertainty that you don't know what is happening. So this is like uncertain for like 50 kilometers or something, and then you can georeference it. But that is how you should do. So there is no question of trained model or untrained model for georeferencing in this case. Whatever the occurrences you have are actually the actual occurrences with the uncertainty associated with it.
Srinivas, does that answer your question? I can take up next.
That's perfect. Yeah.
Okay, so in overwintering sites in Mexico, do monarchs show interspecific niche partitioning?
This was actually the question I was referring to earlier, like comparing between niche. I think you have, but this is slightly different. Like in Mexico, overwintering site, does this phenomenon reported? That's what I meant by this question, specific question.
So there's another part to it. Monarchs are associated commonly with milkweeds, poisonous to other animals, insects. But monarch caterpillars consume the leaf. Do milkweeds occur in Mexico as well? Milkweeds have become invasive in other parts of the world.
This is just a general thing that I wanted to know.
Oh, so I don't think so. Milkweed, any population actually breeds in Mexico. Once they just go there to overwinter and then they proceed their journey towards Canada.
Okay. So the next question is, how does high precipitation impact the physiological parameters in monarchs leading to mortality?
Okay, so what happens if it is cold and if it is wet, then the sunlight is not there, then the temperature will not increase. And once the temperature doesn't increase, monarch cannot actually survive. So that's like the cold conditions with the wetness is a problem because monarchs cannot dry their wings and then they die.
Okay. The next question is from a friend of mine from US Forest Service, Liza. Which sites are more in peril, the overwintering sites or breeding sites due to climate change, agriculture, etc.? Are the ranges for both headed more north?
So the thing is, these overwintering sites, they have become tourist sites. So there are lot many tourists going there, and certainly the tourists, once they go there, there will be some sort of a trouble must be happening to monarchs. And also though these are protected, some of the logging and other facilities are actually available for the locals over there. So actually fir and pine species are protected, but some non-timber forest species they can harvest. So there is a threat, because most of the people, some of the local people are actually depending on those sites, but still there is harvesting happening in those regions. So it is actually threatened, but I would say that local understand the importance of this, and because it is a tourist place, many of the locals are dependent on the tourist activities. So they will certainly try to protect those sites in a sense. So it is a mixed response. I would say some really care, some really don't. But the thing is, it's the problem of overwintering sites is really not the locals, I would say. It is more of the climate, because the climate is going to change, the butterflies, there will be more lethal conditions in those sites. So monarch has to move somewhere, but they might move, but then there are fir and pine trees may not be available in those places where the climate is suitable. So that is more threat to monarchs. And then because the milkweed, the food is from milkweed, and milkweeds are found in agricultural areas. So there are studies done that those habitats are also vulnerable are diminishing. And because of that, monarchs are reducing that. Those studies are also done. But there are many organizations in US who are trying to actually promote milkweed propagation and all that. So because of that, the awareness that we need to save this, we need to conserve this phenomena is there in people in United States and Mexico. So there will be a solution to this. And I don't think there is a problem. Yes, we know, but we also know that we can work out the solutions. So that's the answer, I would say. We shouldn't be worried too much. The awareness is there.
And are the ranges for both headed north for the overwintering sites and breeding sites?
Breeding sites, I haven't worked, but the overwintering sites are really changing to the northward.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I think that's all the questions we have.
Okay.
Naraini ma'am, that was a insightful talk. I am presuming that a lot of people here, it was a very new topic, and some people are really, really interested because they have been working on similar aspects in India. And that is why it was very important to have a talk like this, because, you know, we have had over 50 talks in Big Butterfly Month, and most of the talks are generally for, it's like a mass talk for general citizens. So all of them can be involved, but this is like a real scientific talk with, you know, real interested people wanting to hear what is happening all across the world for butterflies, so they could replicate such work in India. And as you know, in India, it's really, really needed such work, because we have a knowledge black hole, and everything and anything that is worked upon is going to be very, very useful for the future. So, ma'am,
I would like to add here. So the thing, what is happening with this initiative in this 1 month of you are doing awareness among people that this is important, and we need to save biodiversity. We need to have the data. Also, people, those who are working on getting the data, which is very important, because until and unless you have the data, you cannot really see the trends, what is happening. So that is also very good initiative that you take counts of butterflies 30-minute counts and then what is happening. It is going to take time to build the data, but once you really have the data, you can really do wonderful things. And I think I wanted to bring out that point here that once you have the data, you can do many things. So I hope I put across that point in my talk.
Yes, yes, so it absolutely. Was really
good, more theoretical.
Yeah, absolutely, ma'am. And like you said, there has been a lot of, we have had a lot of response for data collection. The 30-minute protocols that you mentioned, there are over 300 such counts being submitted from across India. So this is just a small start. But like you said, we have to start somewhere. We can't, we can't sit and not do anything because we don't have data. A small start today might lead to 2 decades on. It might lead to really, really important work, which is, I think, the need of the hour. So, yes, thank you, ma'am. Thank you for such a great talk. Let me check if there are any other questions here.
Thanks for inviting me. It was a really great initiative, and I'm very happy that I am part of it by giving the talk.
We are also very happy that we could manage to get you and you agreed to be part of Big Butterfly Month. And we are glad that so many people have joined us on Facebook and on the Zoom chat. And there is such level of interest in such a complicated subject also. So I see a bright future for Indian butterflies. Something like I keep saying this, something which my generation could not do. I think youngsters would really pick up these subjects and run with them. And the more they do that, the better it is for our biodiversity, the information we get on it, and the future of our planet, which is also something that we should not forget. So, ma'am, any parting notes for us? Any guiding principles that we should follow?
No.
Collect more data.
Great job.
Collect more data, right?
No. Of course, you need data to do models. Of course, you need data to understand patterns. But that's really good what you are doing, I would say.
Thank you, ma'am. And it has been a great partnership. We have, like you can see, we have so many partners on ground level working really, really hard. And we have been overwhelmed by the response that this Big Butterfly Month has generated. So, great start. And it was lovely to have you with us. And I hope we can have you. These talks are going to continue for the whole year. I hope we can have you back again to discuss this and refresh our memories. Because I'm sure a lot of people will go now after this talk, read up a little bit and get abreast with all the information, latest information out there. And maybe we can do a repeat of this talk sometime soon and have a robust discussion.
I would say read the book, which is very important in understanding all the concepts.
Could you bring it closer to the screen?
Oh, sure.
It says ecological niches and geographic distributions. Yeah. Anything else, ma'am, the author or something that people want to, if they want to find out where
there
this
are
book.
There are multiple authors here.
Okay. If somebody wants to find out about this book online, how could they?
I think the draft copy of this particular book is available on ResearchGate. So if you are interested, just join ResearchGate and search for this book and you will find it.
Yeah, I'm sure half of the people here are already on ResearchGate. Whoever is not, it is a great platform to get to know the latest research happening, not just in India, all over the world. So please get on ResearchGate, get on iNaturalist, keep sending us counts, keep doing counts, keep counting butterflies. I hope it was a good fun talk for all of you and also people watching on Facebook. I hope you guys enjoyed today's talk and thank you, Narayani ma'am, again for such an insightful talk and being kind enough to grace us with your presence. We love to have you. And for me, it was quite insightful. I took a lot of notes and I'm really excited to learn more about overwintering sites of Monarch. It would be a pleasure to see one like physically live. So looking forward to that sometime in the future. Okay, ma'am. So if there are no questions at this point, I could end this meeting right now. Yeah, I think, ma'am, there have been a lot of people who are saying, I just want to mention that a lot of people saying thank you and a very good session and great talk. And there have been lots of compliments. So I wanted to convey that to you. And good evening to everybody and hope you have a great week ahead. And I know, ma'am, you've been busy with a lot of, there's a on and lots of stuff going on. So thank you for taking time out for us. Good night, everybody. Okay.